Suppose you are eating an apple and part of that apple is rotten or it is bad. What will you do? You will take a knife, you will cut the apple and you will throw away the bad part and you will cut or you will eat the remaining part of that apple, right? This is my marker. Tip of this marker or lead of this marker is broken. It's not working. But the rest of the marker is good. In this case, I need to throw away the lead. I do not have to throw away the entire marker, right? Same thing happens in case of doctrine of severability. When a statute is good, but just a part of a statute is bad, you need to throw away just the part which is against the constitution and rest of the statute is really good. Hey everyone, welcome to Law Simple and Pure. I'm your host Dr. Vaishali and in today's lecture, we are going to learn doctrine of severability. Doctrine of severability and doctrine of eclipse, these two important doctrines are there in Article 13 of the Constitution of India. Now remember, these two doctrines, they can be asked for short notes or they can be asked for a long question in a question on judicial review. So if there is a question on judicial review, try to cover doctrine of eclipse and doctrine of severability. If there is a question on Article 13, again you are supposed to cover these two doctrines in that question. And again, a separate short note can be asked on these two questions. So these doctrines are very important and very, very easy to understand. Okay, so if there is a question, how will you write? You are supposed to cover certain points. And what are these points? Number one, what is severability? Number two, origin of the doctrine. Number three, Article 13. Number four, purpose of doctrine of severability. Why it is there in the Constitution? Then explain the doctrine. Okay, then provide case laws, difference between eclipse and doctrine of severability, and then conclude. So you are supposed to cover these many points in your answer to get full marks. What is severability? Severability means separating. Okay, so cutting separate a part of a statute or part of a law is called separating that part from the entire statute. I gave you an example of apple. You can give that example in introduction. So it is not the whole act which is declared as unconstitutional. Just a part of an act which is against the constitution will be taken away from the act and rest of the act remains intact or safe. Origin of this doctrine is there in British law. In a British case, Nordenfeld versus Maxim Nordenfeld Guns and Ammunition Company, the plaintiff, a specialized manufacturer in armaments, decided to sell his company to defendant. So plaintiff decided that he will sell his ammunition company to defendant. With the mutual agreement, they made an agreement that after the agreement, plaintiff would not indulge in any production of guns and other weapons anywhere in the world, and the plaintiff would not compete with the defendant for next 25 years. So this agreement happened between plaintiff and defendant that plaintiff will sell his company to the defendant and he will not indulge in these activities or selling of guns for 25 years or he will not compete with defendant. But it was held by the court that this agreement is against right to trade or it is a restraint of trade. And that's why such agreement is void ab initio. But whether the entire agreement is void ab initio? No. Plaintiff still sold the company to the defendant. So just the part which bans the plaintiff from dealing in the same dealing in the ammunition or arms again for 25 years is not valid because it restricts his freedom of trade, right? So that part of the agreement is bad, but rest of the agreement is good. And this is called doctrine of severability. Next point, you have to provide Article 13 of the Constitution and the relevant provisions. So Article 13 subclause 1 provides all laws in force in the territory of India immediately before the commencement of the Constitution insofar as are inconsistent with the provisions of this part shall to the extent of such inconsistency be void. This part means part 3. Okay, part 3 of the Constitution is about fundamental rights. It begins with the definition of state. Why? Because fundamental rights are given to citizens against state. Then Article 13 is there which provides the definition of law because any law cannot go against the constitution. So law is defined and all the pre-constitution and post-constitution laws, if they are inconsistent with part 3, means with fundamental rights, then they shall be taken away or to the extent of that inconsistency will be declared as void. Okay, so Article 13 subclause 1 is about pre-constitution laws, and Article 13 subclause 2 is about post-constitution laws. So any law, whether pre-constitutional or post-constitutional, if it goes against fundamental right, it will be cut from that law. Okay, so that part of a law which goes against the fundamental right will be declared as void by applying doctrine of severability. So this doctrine is invented by judiciary to protect part 3 or to protect fundamental rights which are there in the constitution. Case laws on doctrine of severability are really interesting. In A.K. Gopalan versus State of Madras, the petitioner, a communist leader, A.K. Gopalan was a communist leader, was detained under the Preventive Detention Act 1950. And he challenged the preventive detention made on the ground that it infringed his fundamental rights under Article 19 and 21 of the Constitution. The Supreme Court held only the unconstitutional provision of the Act is void, okay? And which is that? Section 14 of the Preventive Detention Act, which, because it goes against the Constitution, just that part is void and rest of the Preventive Detention Act is good. So the concerned part, which goes against part 3 of the Constitution, is taken away from Preventive Detention Act and rest of the statute is kept intact. There are so many other case laws. In Minerva Mills versus Union of India, the court struck down section 4 and 55 of 42nd Amendment Act as it was found ultra vires beyond the amending power of the parliament, and it was declared as a void. So Constitutional Amendment Act was declared, a part of that was declared void because it was against the Constitution. In State of Bombay versus Balsara, it was held that violative provisions of a Bombay Prohibition Act 1949 do not affect the validity of the entire act. So only a part which goes against part 3 of the Constitution is bad, but the rest of the statute is good. In Kyoto Hololan versus Jajulu, court upheld the validity of the 10th schedule while striking down its paragraph 7 for violating the provisions of Article 368(2). So in short, if a part of a statute goes against the Constitution and that part is separable, then in that case that part must be separated by applying the doctrine of severability. When you can apply doctrine of severability? Number 1, a part of a statute must be against part 3 of the Constitution. Number 2, a part which goes against the Constitution must be separable. Okay, it should be capable of taking away from the statute. For example, you are eating an apple and a part of an apple is bad, you can take away that part. But if after cutting the apple you find out the entire apple is bad or it is rotten, then you have to throw the entire apple. Similarly, if a part of a statute which is against part 3 of the Constitution is bad, and if it is not possible to take away the part from a statute, okay, without disturbing the statute, then the entire statute will be declared as a void statute. So these are the conditions which must be there for application of doctrine of severability. Now, a most important thing you should provide in your answer is, what is the difference between doctrine of severability and doctrine of eclipse? Provide a difference between these two doctrines, okay? So this is my marker. I can take away the bad tip, and this is doctrine of severability, okay? Doctrine of eclipse. If there is a big apple tree and below the apple tree there is a small apple tree which is not able to grow, in that case let the small tree be there. After some years, if the big apple tree is cut, then the other tree can grow once the shadow is gone, once the eclipse is gone. Similarly, and that is the difference between doctrine of severability and doctrine of eclipse. Basically, doctrine of severability is applicable to pre and post constitutional laws. Okay, so pre-constitutional law, if they are against the Constitution, they are void. If post constitutional law, they, a part of them goes against part 3, again that is valid. Doctrine of eclipse, if pre-constitutional laws are there and they are valid law or they are in application, but then Constitution is made, okay, and if a part of those laws is inconsistent with the Constitution, okay, then that part will not be taken away, but it will be left there, okay, it will stay in moribund condition or dormant condition. It means it will sleep there, it will not be applied. But once, if anything happens and Constitution is amended, then that eclipse will be removed and the other statute will again come in picture. So this is the difference between doctrine of severability and doctrine of eclipse. provide each and every point. Okay, so while writing a short note, try to cover each and every point provided by me. What is severability? What is the origin of the doctrine? What is Article 13? What is the purpose of doctrine of severability? It is made in order to protect the fundamental rights. Okay, then explanation. Explain all the things which are there in the doctrine of severability. Like it must be separated, it should be separable. If it is not, then entire statute will be removed. Then provide all the case laws explained by me. Provide a difference between doctrine of severability and doctrine of eclipse. And then conclude. Okay, this is really easy answer and it is very good for scoring. So do not forget it. And if there is a question on judicial review, provide this doctrine in that question also to score more. That's it for the day. Stay tuned till my next lecture. Goodbye and good luck.